Holy Spirit, come from Psalms 1 through 3. Blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. For his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the river of water, to bring forth his fruit in his season. His name also shall not be seen. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Lord, bless the reason to give you his holy word.
Thank you. talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art at heart man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed.
And I was afraid, and I laid in thee and I found in the earth. No, now thou hast been found.
His Lord answered and said unto him, thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest, and I reap where I sow not, and gather where I have not strawed. Take therefore the talent from him, and give it unto him which hath 10 talents.
You are a comforter. So let us always remember that you are a comforter. Heavenly Father, we lift right now. Touch him right now. Touch him right now in a special way. As he is prepared to bring your word, oh God, he asks you to just guide him and protect him and just let him just go into your righteousness right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, be with our pastor, Reverend Gavin, right now, and Sister Gavin. Be with them as they travel, oh God. Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you for their faithfulness and we thank you for the journey. Heavenly Father, we ask you just to bless them more abundantly because of the service that they rendered to this church. And most importantly, deacons will come down.
Thank you. sorry, I'm here to do the announcements at the morning pulpit. All right.
Thank you for with warm appreciation. Thank you for kind words, prayers, cards, and loss of our niece, Karen Alfonso Posley. A note to tell you thank you so much. You always have a thoughtful touch to Second Baptist members. Special thanks to all of you. To know you is to know people who are kind, considerate, and thoughtful. To know you is to be grateful for Amen. Special things you do.
Amen.
For everything you've done, for being the special people that you are. Thank you so very much. Glad that you all. Larry and Sandra Stewart and Lula McKee.
Amen. Amen.
To our Second Baptist Church family, thank you all so much for the love, concern, and support that you have shown during the illness, passing, and homegoing service for our dear friend Dorothy Jones. Your prayer cards, calls, and participation in her service were appreciated more than we can say. You have shown once again that Second Baptist Church, we truly are family. Our prayers and thanks are with you, Larry and Sandra Stewart and Eula McKee. Amen.
Amen.
I appreciate the youth help, and we're trying to help them grow. They're doing a wonderful job. Okay. All right. This is from Kalamazoo Valley, and I'll say the person's name at the end. I am pleased to inform you that you have been named to the academic honors list for fall 2018 semester. Excellence in scholarship achievement at Kalamazoo Valley Community College is recognized by naming those students who complete a minimum of 6 credits of academic work during the semester with a minimum grade point average of a 3.5. On behalf of the faculty and staff, I congratulate you for your outstanding record and wish you continued success. Feel free to contact me if I can be of any service to you and keep up the good work. And this is to Jasmine Monique Rushing. Is Jasmine here?
No.
Jasmine?
She's not here.
All right, Jasmine.
Amen.
Okay. Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church. This is going to be dear pastor and youth director. The youth department of Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church will be sponsoring their annual community walk on Monday, January 21st, 2019, in commemoration of the late Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. holiday. The walk will begin from Martin Luther King School on Britton and ending at Ebenezer Baptist Church at 214 Britton, where a program will be held at 9:30 a.m. At 9 a.m., those individuals participating in the walk may park their cars at Ebenezer, where transportation will be available to you to Martin Luther King School for the walk back to Ebenezer. We are asking your youth choir, praise dancers, or drill team to participate in this event. Please call the church no later than than January 17th to let us know if you will be participating in this. And this is from Reverend Brian A. Claiborne, pastor. And this will be posted back. There's a flyer, too. Be posted back in the prayer room. Okay. Thank you to my brothers and sisters in Christ for this scribe. Okay. Who was this from? Okay. Sister Musetta here is thanking the church for the quilt and all the messages that you wrote to her, and she's like to thank Deaconess Beatty who designed the quilts and continues to do this. And so Sister Hilliard is saying God bless you and thank you for all that you have wrote on the quilt. And we want to thank Sister Beatty and keep her in your prayers too. Okay, in your bulletin, the Martin Luther King celebration is January 21st. There's one at 6 p.m. We'll be at the Overflow Church on Napier Avenue, so if you can participate in that. There's a leadership meeting with Interim Pastor Smith on January 20th after the morning service in the Fellowship Hall. All ministry presidents, chairpersons, deacons, and trustees are asked to please be represented. There will not be fellowship after service, but there will be a meal served to the ministry leaders attending the workshop. Thank you for your service and commitment, Pastor Andrew Smith. There's a membership meeting on Sunday, January 27th at 4 p.m., and it is of vital importance that you all be there. Also, you should have one of these in your bulletin, and I'm just going to read part of it. Please be advised that as a result of the retirement of Pastor Kenneth M. Gavin and pursuant to Article 5 of the Bylaws of Second Baptist Church, the Pulpit Search Committee has scheduled a membership meeting to elect a new pastor on Sunday, February 10th, probably at 4 p.m. in the sanctuary of the church. The proposed candidate's name was presented to the joint boards of deacons and trustees for their approval on Saturday, January 5th at 10 a.m., and the candidate was approved for presentation to the membership by more than a two-thirds majority vote. The vote will be by secret ballot. So I'm not going to read it all, but just please read the announcements in your bulletin and all this information, because there is a lot of important information in there. Thank you. That concludes your announcements, and now we will have the welcome.
Amen.
Are there any first-time visitors, please stand. Second-time visitors, please stand. Third-time visitors, please stand.
Any visitors,
please stand.
We're sorry, Reverend Smith, but we have no visitors today, but we're going to sing your song. So we're going to sing your song. We will sing your song.
Thank you. participate in the black is a freshman at Benton Harbor High School.
Amen.
I'm here to do the Black History Highlight to our pastor, Reverend Smith, Reverend Jefferson, and Reverend Scott, to the beautiful mothers, and to everyone in the congregation. Black History Highlight today, Shirley Anita St. Hill Chisholm. According to Ms. Shirley, you don't make progress by standing on the sidelines, whimpering and complaining. You make progress by implementing ideas. Shirley Chisholm was born November 20th, 1926, in Brooklyn, New York, to immigrant parents from the Caribbean. When Shirley turned five, she and her two sisters were sent to live with their maternal grandmother. There they lived in Barbados, where they attended school in a one-room schoolhouse. She remained there until 1934, and as a result, she spoke with a recognizable West Indian accent throughout her life. Graduating with an excellent academic record from Brooklyn Girls High School, Shirley Chisholm earned a scholarship to study sociology at Brooklyn College. She quickly became active in the political circles, joining the Harriet Tubman Society, serving as an Urban League volunteer, and winning prizes in debate. While beginning to establish her profile in her community, she also impressed her professors with a powerful speaking style and was encouraged to enter politics. She received her sociology degree with honors in 1946 while working in a nursery school. She studied for a master's degree in elementary education at Columbia University, where she met her husband, Comrade Chisholm, whom she married in 1949. It was 2 years later she received her master's degree in early education. She became known as Fighting Shirley Chisholm, unbought and unbossed. She won the election and became the first African-American woman elected to the United States House of Representatives. Oh, how we wish we had Shirley there now. During her first term in the Congress, Shirley Chisholm hired a mostly African-American all-female staff and spoke out for civil rights, women's rights, the poor, and against the Vietnam War. And in 1970, she was elected for a second term. And Shirley always surrounded herself by good people. Betty Shabazz was the wife of the late, in the black, she's the wife of the late Malcolm X, Dorothy Hikes, Shirley's there, and Marian Anderson. And Shirley didn't stop there. Surrounding herself in good company. And that's what our young people have to do. They have to surround themselves with people like them, to speak like them, and look like them, and act like them. Here she's with Rosa Parks, Coretta Scott King, and Elnora Holmes Norton. In 1972, Shirley Chisholm became the first African-American candidate for a major party's nomination for president. Chisholm claimed that none of the candidates represented the interests of African Americans or the inner city poor. I won't read all of this, I'll just read the bold. And Shirley stated in her own words, "I'm running for president of all the people, and I need the help of all the people." She put up a good fight for president. Shirley Chisholm's campaign wasn't easy. During the road to her primaries, she faced so many things. She survived multiple assassination attempts. She had to sue to make sure she would appear in televised debates, and she fought her way onto primary ballots in 12 different states. Though she didn't win, but in the end, Shirley Chisholm won 10% of the total vote for the Democratic National Convention. And what she did was extremely important. She cleared the way for future African-American candidates We all enjoyed 8 years of President Barack Obama. And in our own words, Shirley Chisholm wrote, speaking about her unsuccessful bid, the next time a woman runs, or black, or Jew, or anyone from a group that the country is not ready for to elect to its highest office, I believe that he or she will be taken serious from the start. I ran because somebody had to do it first. Shirley Chisholm cracked that glass ceiling. She was a co-founder of NOW, National Organization of Women, founding member of the Congressional Black Caucus, founding member of the National Women's Political Caucus, co-founded the National Congress of Black Women. And she's honored. She's on the 37th Black Heritage Forever Stamp. The United States Postal Service pays tribute to the pioneer congresswoman. Shirley Chisholm with insurance issuance of limited edition of the 32nd Black Heritage Forever Stamp. And this happened in 2014. You know, it's something about the name of Shirley. We also have a Shirley in our congregation. And that is Miss Shirley Featherstone Carter. She's also strong and courageous and very strong in her faith. And in her own words, I want history to remember me, not as the first black woman to have made a bid for the presidency of the United States, but as a black woman who lived in the 20th century and who dared to be herself. I want to be remembered as a catalyst for change in America. I would like them to say that Shirley Chisholm had guts. That's how I would like to be remembered. In 2015, she was honored in her death award for the Presidential Medal of Freedom. And then she stated, I ran because, I think I've said that one already, but to Miss Shirley Anita Chisholm, we will always remember your contribution to our treasured African-American history, and thank you.
You may please stand and give her for our Black History Highlight. Amen. gonna make it. Amen. We're gonna claim victory. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We thank our God for you because, amen, singing out of their heart. Lord, I want to do what you tell me. Service. sponsor you all to come and take part in this service today, because this is a powerful service where we make a commitment to God that we will serve Him with our all. Amen. Amen. All officers come at this time. Amen. God is good. And all the time, God is good. Amen. Amen. As the interim pastor of this congregation, we carry on with the installation service. Amen. They have been put in place down through the years. Amen. By the pastor. To do you in the presence of God in this congregation. Here at Second Baptist, pledge your faithfulness to serve, loyalty, love, and sincerity, stewardship of your gift and talent to the ongoing and betterment of this church in your respective ministry. Those that pledge to just say I do together. Amen. Say it with power.
I do.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Do you also pledge to work cooperating, compassionate, and workmanship with your fellow Christian servants to glorify the Lord and edify this body of Christ here at Second Baptist Church? Now, do you pledge to step down at the end of the designated time of your term, but remain faithful in your support and cooperation in your attitude and the spirit of other leaders who will follow you in the service? Now, Colossians 4 and 6 read, so let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer every man. In communication with others, will you make every reasonable effort to apply this scripture. I'm going to say that again, this scripture, and especially in communicating with those who are the household of faith. Do you?
I do.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you so much for agreeing to apply these things that have been set in place. And I do ask that you would just turn around and face the congregation at this time. Amen. Here at Second Baptist, 600 Don Acton Drive, 2019, we present your ministry leaders at this time for 2019. Them to the
Thank you. different key, I might be in any key today.
It's all right.
I shall pour it
all right.
Venus. Venus was always very comical. But on Sundays, when we would stop here at Morgan, there was always jokes. We would end up Pastor Gavin back down here and to listen to her. And I said to her one Sunday, I said, you know what? And one Sunday we was going to have a fashion show, and I just have to tell this. She walked up over here and she was standing, looking at me up and down, and she said, "Are you going to be in the fashion show this afternoon?" And I said, "Yes, why?" She said, "Do you have another pair of shoes to wear?" And I said, "Yes, Venus." But she says, "I was going to tell you, those shoes you got on need to be shined. Don't wear them." She says, "I'm afraid you're going to wear them this afternoon." And I said, "Well, I'll go home." She said, "Well, listen, I made it better than that. You just go home and have your son Brian to shine your shoes, and you get a chance and be here." But you know what? This afternoon, the whole downtown got down here. And she told me, she said, "I'm going to sit on the sideline and I'm going to watch you. And if you don't have them shoes shine on, I'll call you out." Venus was sitting right there on the sideline, and the joke was on me because I did have my shoes shined. But I'm just trying to let you know how much I miss Venus.
Thank you all for giving up here because they've been giving us up today.
Trina and all of the rest of the leaders, amen. Amen. Doing a wonderful job with the choir. Thank you for bringing our young people out today.
Amen.
Amen. On Good Sunday, amen. We praise God for that, amen. We are so grateful for another day's journey. Amen. Because this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. And would anybody rejoice with me this day? Because this is the day that the Lord has made. Amen. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Enough time, man, spent, well spent. And thank God for everything that has taken place in this sanctuary. Amen. We thank you, and we continue to invite God's Spirit, amen, to endow us, amen, with a fresh word, amen. Amen. And our scripture today is coming from 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter and 58th verse. Amen. Amen. Let's read it together. It said, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain.
Put the wrong ingredient in it.
Uh-huh.
And all of a sudden,
It just come crumbling down and a bunch of people in there. Parking garage. In the bridges that we travel throughout this nation. We travel through all types of bridges that are some of them mile long and they're made out of concrete and 18 wheels and when you have a bad luck, you got 18 wheels and all type of vehicles sitting on the bridge, Brother Scott. Something to think about. This is just something to think about. Man have made nothing solid that will last, that will hold, that won't fail. Even in the unexpected time, things that men made and have put together were failing. But they were singing a song. Now, I heard him say that Jesus Christ was the same. Yeah, he's the same today, yesterday, and forever. He's the same. Yeah, because his name is Jesus. And on this road to glory, while we travel through a strange land, pure land, this is not our home. God expected us to be solid. He expected us to be solid in our talk, solid in our love. Yeah, solid in the joy that we have. And we said we can make it do it for the night, but joy will come in the morning. He wants us to be solid. For him, not for us. I think I was reading in Genesis, he said that everything that God created, he created for himself. Yeah. But we have the advantage to use and misuse the thing that God created for mankind. But still, he expects us to be solid. Solid in our faithfulness. Yeah, solid in our walk, in our talk. He expects us to be solid in our loyalty to him. Why? Why do we expect that? Because we are saints. We've been baptized in the name of the Father, baptized in the name of the Son, baptized in the name of the Holy Ghost. Somebody might say the Holy Spirit. But it's the same. We've been baptized for Christ. Paul said that the life that I live now, I live it in the flesh. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, the life that I live now, I live it in the flesh, but I live it through Jesus Christ. So we are crucified. When we said we are crucified with Christ, he expected us to be silent. Even in our commitment. When we are committed to Christ, we make a commitment to Christ, he expected us to be silent. Silent saints. There's a song that writer said, when the saints go washing in, I'm going to be in that number. But in order for us to be in that number, we got to be solid. Yeah. Yeah. We got to be solid saints in Christ. We got to be solid in our dedication for Christ Jesus. Those that came this morning and said that I do. Oh, you did a great thing this morning. But I want to let you know you got to be solid. Because you said I do. And he expects for us to I do. Because we made a commitment to God and man in front of the congregation. So he expects for us to be solid in everything that we do. Church members ought to be solid saints in Christ Jesus. But it said that church members are becoming few. In view. As time goes by, we're getting few. In
Somebody might have said, time ain't like it have been. Yeah, each day we get older, or each day we get closer to the grave. Pastor Bill McAfee used to always say that every time I take a bath. I took a shower last night, early this morning. Every time I take a bath, I see a lot of dirt in the bathtub. And I'm like, where's all this dirt coming from? You know, time after time, and you still got in the bathtub. Pastor Gavin, Pastor Gavin must be talking about me now. But Pastor McAfee will say that that's the way life is. That's my life. So in other words, what I'm saying is, Sister Beth, when you see a lot of dirt in your bathtub, you're constantly cleaning it out. It's just our life. That's our life. Our life is going down the drain. Time is getting shorter. In short, so we got to live a life. We got to evangelize. We got to invite people to church. Because Christ is meant for his house to be full. Now, I was looking yesterday, just sitting back up here, and over 400 people sitting out here. I'm saying, my Lord, my God, the only time we can build churches up now is out of building. Sunday morning service, people won't come to church. Well, at a funeral yesterday, they won't come to church today and say, thank you, Lord. Solid Sundays. With so many distractions and hindrances, many apparently no longer feel that church attended is vital to their relationship with God. But guess what? Brother Bobby McAfee, Scott got something on the McCree Marquee out there, said summer assembly. Yeah. It was necessary. Y'all read that when you go out. Some. We must come together, saints. We must come together and lift up the name of Jesus. Because Jesus said that if I be lifted up on the earth, I will draw all men unto me. For many, the worship service have become a place to sporting events, TV programs, shopping mall, family reunion, recreation activities. Birthdays party, holiday adventure. You know, when all these things happen, the solid saints supposed to show up. They're supposed to show up the next day, Reverend Jeff. They're supposed to come to church and lift up the name of Jesus. Because he has blessed us that families might come together and pray together. They might come together to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. I can remember the time when you can depend on church folks to show up in the church service, even if they had to walk to church for some distance. I got to recall when I was coming up, I think we lived probably about 8 miles from the church. Yeah, my father would take us to church and drop us off. We would go there with mom in church. And my mom was a sick lady. And I used to wonder, my mom is sick. And well, we can stay home today. She said, no, boy, we're going to church today. Yeah, because I'm sick at home. And I get to church and we'll be sick. But guess what? But when I leave, I leave church, I leave younger. Because the move of the Holy Spirit, the visitation of the Holy Spirit, came and eased the pain, took away all the worry, took away all the hate. Yeah, the Holy Ghost would do something. So she came to the church sick, Sunday, every other little son, yeah, there, little son. Yeah. But she came. And the Lord blessed her. So church members, we ought to be silent in our walk. There's a hunger and thirst within the soul that only worship service can take care of that. It's something about when you start lifting up holy hand in the sanctuary and worship him in spirit and in truth. Songwriter said, I think I feel a little bit better now. Because something on the inside of me is coming out of me. It's making me say hallelujah. Oh, it's making my flesh crawl. But it's on the inside of me. The summer says that sometimes it caused me to tremble. Have you ever had a move of the Holy Ghost? And he caused you to tremble. What them little bundles that we come up on you, they said, flesh bomb. Goosebumps. Your Reverend Scott said, goosebumps. You got some goosebumps to come along. That let you know that something is going on. God is doing something. He's working the work on the inside of you. But you gotta let him use you. You gotta stay silent. Silent saints. I think I told Sister Shirley last week, Shirley Collin, that I really appreciate you. I appreciate your faith and your strongness in the Lord. And when I was preparing this sermon, I thought about her. Solid, saint in God. She hadn't missed a bit. She's been here every Sunday behind her sister there. So we do have saints that is solid in the walking, solid in the talk, in the sanctuary.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, solid saint. When we worship him, we warn, yearn, the witness of a mighty move of the Holy Spirit. Greatly desire to see God glory revealed to his people. God has been done a good work in the sanctuary. I've seen healing take place in the sanctuary. We've seen the glory of God take Pastor Gavin to another level. When the doctor said, I can't do you no good. It looked bad. But God sent him to another doctor. See, I know a doctor that got all the medicine. Matter of fact, he got more medicine than him and your gun and his gun that we have in this universe. He has healing power, saints. His pain is his people. A deep hunger for the bread that come down from him. Yeah, Jesus did declare that I am the bread of life. Yeah, he didn't hunger. You don't have to hunger no more. All you got to do is accept him. He didn't thirst. You don't have to thirst no more because he is the living one. Saints. Solid saints. A sincere walking, a genuine revival to take place in the midst of God's people. We all crave that we will have a powerful and a better understanding of the eternal God. We gladly invest in time and energy into the worship service. I don't know about you, but it was one Friday night at a revival at Local Grove Baptist Church that I believe that something happened. I don't know what it was, but I started feeling strange. I was expecting to start running, but something happened. Something came over me. I didn't understand it, what it was, but when I grew up, I understood that it was the Holy Ghost. compassion on me.
Yeah, Lord.
So family, keep inviting family members to come and attend to worship service. And they often come, they often came early, and they stayed late in order to see God's face. They wasn't in a big hurry, for therefore they were on their way to somewhere else. So when they came to church, they came to church. When they came to worship God, that they did. They worship God in spirit and in truth. Yes, my sisters and my brother, they did not want a bunch of stories and a bunch of jokes. But they wanted, the God they wanted to hear what thus said the Lord. They want to hear that that is the way that seems right to man. But the end is death. Yeah, they want to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. I recall Paul said that if we hide this gospel of Jesus Christ, it will be hid from those that are lost, that have no hope. If we don't preach the gospel, if we don't tell them the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life, they will stay lost. If we don't tell them that Jesus is the way, they won't find the way. If we don't tell them that Jesus is the truth, they won't know the truth. If we don't tell them that Jesus is the light of the world, no, they won't find the light. But if we tell them that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but would have everlasting life, I believe that they'll have a change of life and they will become one of us. They might ask the question, what must I do to be saved? Believe and be baptized and thou shalt be saved. But we got to tell the church. We got to tell them. It's good to have jokes, but God put them in not a place for joking. It's good to have storytelling, but God told Paul to preach the gospel. Be instant in season and out of season. Preaching with him on the head. Preaching in a way. Tell him that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And as a result, like Paul the apostle, he knew who he had to meet. Paul knew that he had believed the Lord Jesus, our Savior. And unlike many today, they also knew. They believed, therefore. We know what we believe. We believe that Jesus is the truth and the life. We believe that he's able to make a way out of no way. We believe that he's a heart fixer and a mind regulator. Yeah, but when the storm of life came, the most saints they stood firm. They stood on a solid rock. When the devil came to tempt them, they stood firm. When trouble erupted all around them, the most saints they stood firm. And God is expecting us to stand on a firm ground. Yeah, when persecution occurred, they stood firm. When fear threatened them, they stood firm. They stood upon the solid rock because they were solid saints. And when sorrow invaded our life, guess what? They stood firm. Thank you, Shirley, for standing firm on the solid rock. They were discerning of somebody had built upon the rock, upon the sand. They were indeed saints standing upon sand. So they had to be standing firm in what they believed in. Luke the church world is in desperate need today for some solid saints. Men, women, boys and girls, babies, who will live a holy and a godly lifestyle. Who will be honest in their business and dealing. Who will put their hand, who will not put their hands on the plow and not look back. In other words, those that will put their hands on the plow and don't look back. Jesus said that if you put your hands on the plow and you look back, you're not fit for the kingdom of God. But if you don't look back, if you keep going, keep pressing on, you can stand firm on the side of rock. Yeah. So who will live a lifestyle? Who will be honored in their business and dealing? A solid lifestyle. Who will be faithful to the marriage vow? A solid rock. That's what Christ expects. Who will hold on to the nail scarred hand of Jesus Christ? That solid rock. Who will abide in the word and pray fervent prayer? And who have done all to stand? Therefore, I said, stand on the solid rock. Who won't run when the going get tough? Oh, you know how it is, brother. When the going get tough, when things look rough, things fall apart. Oh, we just take off running. We're running trying to find something better. But Jesus expects for us to be solid rock. Church, he expects us to be solid. Stay solid. Solid rocks in Jesus Christ. Who won't be distracted about gossiping and rumors? Who won't default in their God-given responsibility? Who won't allow sinful world to influence them? The Lord is looking for solid saints. Y'all stay with me now. Don't go nowhere. Don't leave me. Keep your head held up. I'll be out of here after a while. He is looking for faithfulness in church attending. Solid faithfulness in giving out tithes and offerings. Faithfulness in our private devotion with him. Faithfulness in witness to the lost about Jesus Christ. Because Jesus said that if I be lifted up on the earth, that I'll draw all men unto me. Faithful to do the job without complaining. Faithful in going through stress time. You know, I'm just stressed out now. I can't do nothing there. I'm just going to sit down and rest a little while because it's too much stress on me. There's too much going on with me. There's too many things happening around me. But Christ expects for us to be solid. Don't worry about it because I can say in him I live and move and have my being. Solid. When you get spread, they solid. And our faithful in giving the glory to God.
Amen.
Oh yeah, God get all the glory.
Amen.
He wants us to be faithful in saying, thank you, Lord. Faithful in praising him. Faithful in lifting up in him. Finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord, in the power of his might. Therefore, stand, therefore, in the living of Christ, who has made us free. And do not be entangled against with the yokes of bondage. Yes, my sister and my brother, let not be weary in wisdom. In due season we'll reap if we faint not. Or let be faith that won't faint. Therefore, my brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always, and abiding in the works of the Lord. For that you know that your labor is not. to submit to God. Silas means submit yourself, therefore, to God. Silas means resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. I think our young folks sang a song that we're going to kick the devil out. Yeah, Silas means knowing that it's the devil work, it's demon possessed. Silas means he needs Silas saints to humble yourself in the sight of God. Amen. He needs Silas saints to be like Peter was. Peter went to the altar, to the temple at prayer time, and the lame man was at the temple. Peter and John said, "Silver and gold, such that I have, I give thee. Such as I give you in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." Oh, we got to have that silver and gold. We got to offer Jesus. To tell me that Peter told the lame man to look on us. And the lame man looked on him, and he picked him up by the hand. And to tell me when he picked him up, his ankle bone received strength. And the lame man entered into the temple, a place that he had been sitting at for years, but never had been in the temple to say, "Thank you, Lord, you've been good to me." And now we in the temple, Silas saints. Jesus, when he came down through 42 generations, he came down being a Silas saint. He came down as a Silas Messiah. He came down as a solid bread of life. He said that I am that I am. He was solid because he said that me and my Father is one. He was just being solid, and he was being just being real with him. He came down because he knew that man didn't have no way out. If he had to came down, we would not have a way out. But he came down to redeem mankind of all their sins. I don't know about you, Yeah, to build up on a solid rock. Our foundation gotta be solid, burdens, solid men up on the rock. So we gotta tell him, everywhere you go, be solid, David. Be solid with that baseball, man. Knock it out of the park. Be solid with it. Be solid with your high up, God bless you. Solid with your feelings. When you hit it, just think about Jesus. When you swing, just say, Jesus. And I'm not gonna strike out because I got Jesus down on his side of me. He won't let you strike out. He won't let you move. He'll hold you. Side of saints, go to the church and go. You can come today. Come out down the country for baptism. Or you can come back first in this period. Yes, my sister, my brother. I believe if you come today, you're saying that I do. Amen. I want to be a solid saint.
Amen.
If you come today, he'll spend you today. All you gotta do is come. You can come by Bella candidate for baptism, or you can come by nursing the spirit. But if you don't have him in your life, you don't think he's in your life, you all come today. You know, Jesus said, what the he didn't have an ear. Let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. So if the Spirit is saying, come today. Just grab that person next to you and say, walk with me. You're a solid saint. Walk with me down the altar. Come to the altar today. Be solid.
Yeah, Lord.
Give your life to the Lord. If you want to be a Christian and you want to be more like Jesus, and if you know it in your heart, you ought to come. You ought to come today by the blood of the Spirit, wanting more than any man. Because one of these days, my sisters and my brothers, the blood gonna get cold. The blood gonna stop flowing. So, we need to, while the blood is running warm in our veins, if you're not acquainted with the Messiah, which is the Christ, you ought to come today. Because Jesus declared that he came that we might have life.
Could we get somebody to come and stand for Brother Paul Bear? Amen. Somebody to come and stand for Brother Whitfield. Somebody to come and stand for, Cynthia, Princess Pearl, Cynthia. If you know someone that is going through, come and stand for that person because they need special prayer. Amen. Sister Katie Powell or Sister Ruthie Green. Amen. And there's so many go on and on. Standing Sister Kathy Bailey or Ernie Bailey or Brother Walter Broad. We all need to come in and intercede for somebody. I don't know about you, but I always stand in need of prayer. And it feels good when somebody stopped by and said, look, I just want to pray with you. I'm like, my God, thank you, you know. You know, when I was coming up, the preachers would stop by. They would pray with us. They would anoint us. They would pray with mom and dad. They would lay hands on us. Things happened. We made it. Only by the grace of God. His amazing grace. Thank you, Elsie.
That's by the grace of God. Amen.
Let every heart say amen.
Amen.
Somebody amen.
Amen.
Amen. Father, we thank you. We praise you, God. We glorify your name right now, God. God, we speak in those things as not as though they are, God. And Lord, as we squeeze the hand of the person that we're holding right now, God, we pray for them right now. We pray strength for them right now, God. We pray encouragement for them right now, God. We pray right now, God, that you cover the family right now in the name of Jesus. God, we pray right now, God, the hand that I'm holding right now, God, that you do your will in their life, oh God. Father God, we pray right now, God, that your will will be done, oh God. Now, God, we thank you right now, God, for meeting every need, oh God. Meeting every need of their family, oh God. Meeting every need of their health situation, oh God. Lord, we pray right now, God, in the name of Jesus. Father God, have your way, God. Have your way, oh God, in their lives, oh God. Have your way, oh God, in their finances, oh God. Have your way, oh God, in their health, oh God. Lord, we pray right now, God. Have your way, Jesus. Have your way, God. Move like never before, oh God. Move like never before, oh God. In the name of Jesus. God, we pray right now, God. We pray right now, God. God, we pray for our family members right now, God. We pray for this church, oh God, in the name of Jesus. We pray for Second Baptist right now, God. We pray for those that will be coming, oh God. Lord, we thank you right now, oh God, for those that will be coming, oh God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Now, God, we pray, oh God. We pray right now, Jesus, that everything that is out of order, oh God, not only in our lives, oh God, but Father God, in the lives of those, oh God, that we're sitting in need of, oh God. God, we pray right now that you realign, oh God. Realign everything that is out of order, oh God. In the name of Jesus. God, we know that, oh God, that you can regulate sugar diabetes, oh God. We know that you can regulate our high blood pressure, oh God. Lord, we pray right now in faith, oh God, that you regulate, oh God, anything that is out of order in our lives, oh God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you right now, God. We thank you right now, God, in the name of Jesus. Now we bind the hand of the enemy in the name of Jesus. You have no authority. You have no power over our lives right now. You have no power over our children's lives right now. Lord, we come against you right now. And we come against the enemy right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Now, God, we lift your name upon high, God. We magnify your name, Jesus. We honor you all right now, God. We extol you for who you are, God. We thank you for making a way out of no way, God. And we give you praise, we give you honor, and we give your name the glory. Let every heart say amen. Come on, somebody, amen. Amen. Amen, 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 amen. Believe it so. Believe, amen. Believe, amen.
Amen. still honor God. We thank God for the message. We thank God for everything that taking place in the sanctuary. Y'all pray for me that I would be shorter. I prepare today when the Holy Spirit comes, he just take me another level, a different way of, you know, the Spirit is God coming in, he's just not coming in. You can't truly control it. So we got to keep in mind that the Word let us know that the Spirit not going to dwell with man always. So when he comes, we just got to, you know, let him use it. So let's stand for him. Amen. Closing prayer. Benediction. Thank you, Deacon Byrne, Kenny. Thank you. Grace of our Lord.